Musicians, I'm David Wilde, and more importantly, this is Ann and Nancy Wilson from Heart. Thank you so much. That was great. That was just great.
Thank you.
We love them, but we want to hear them talk.
that was uproarious.
what sort of scary creature inspired Barracuda?
Oh, it was a record industry dude.
The scariest of all.
Yeah. It was a guy that, in Detroit, I'll never forget it. And, you know, we were young and naive and really idealistic and new into the biz.
We still are, though. We're just old and naive and idealistic.
Yeah, right, right. And, you know, he just, like, came backstage after a Heart show and just was like, hey, babe, you know, and say, what kind of relationship do you and your sister really have? Can I watch?
The implication, you know, being incestuous.
Right.
Needless to say, it pissed me off. I mean, just that he would degrade our relationship in a way, can I watch, you know? And so the words to Barracuda came out of that.
What's your first memory of music whatsoever?
Well, from the cradle, I remember through the bars of the actual crib, our mom singing lullabies, yeah. You know, the curly-headed baby song. And
same with me.
A lot of kind of bluesy, smoky voiced. Peggy Lee. She had kind of a Peggy Lee voice. Our mom did. Our dad, too. Our mom and dad both. We did a lot of singing in our family, you know, like, but very first memories were of being sung to.
Yeah.
And a lot of music around in the house.
And what's the first time you sang together? Would you have been hearing, like, the Everly Brothers growing up, that sort of stuff, or no?
Yeah, that, too.
Yeah, we used to go around.
Older.
A little bit older. We'd go camping, you know, as a family, and we have a third sister, Lynn. So we had the ideal three-part harmony situation. She's the oldest of the three of us, and we'd go from, like, tent to tent and sing Kathy's Clown, you know.
That's right,
yeah. Remember that?
God,
we called ourselves the Prunes, and that was our first band, really.
Not to be confused with the Electric
that
Prunes.
That was before the Electric
Prunes.
Later.
Yes. Much
they
later.
Stole our name.
Bastards.
Yeah.
Can you give us a little bit of Kathy's Clown, just from, you know, however much you'd like?
Don't want your love anymore.
Right?
Don't want your key. Sure, I die each time I hear this sound. Here he comes, that's Kathy's Clown.
Thank you.
Where you go to stay?
Do that with an accent, though. You have to have the accent.
That little twang?
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Oh, the twang is the thing.
Yeah.
Now, we should explain. You grew up in Pacific Northwest, but also in Taiwan. Is that true?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How did that shape your exposure to music? Do you remember anything from that time?
Oh, yeah.
It shaped our family by making us so close-knit that when we were driving in the family station wagon across the continent, you know, several times, back and forth to Camp Lejeune, Quantico, Camp Pendleton, out to Taiwan. We were always singing.
We drove there.
You know, we were singing as a family. So
yeah.
Our parents taught us every song they knew, and then we kids parroted them back, you know, and that's how it got us started.
How old would you have been when you were in Taiwan?
Well, I was 7, 8, and 9, so.
And I was like 3 and 4.
What would have been the first record each of you bought? I assume you actually could buy separately. What was your first record, Anne?
Baby Love by the Supremes.
You started high point.
I was really young, and I bought Steve Allen, comedian guy, you know. There was a song called Roadhog.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, remember that?
Roadhog.
Roadhog, do-do-do-do, or something. It was the, you know, little kid thing to buy.
You know, I always heard the Steve Allen influence in your work. That's funny that it was such a defining input. For years, he went around saying he's written millions of songs. I never knew anyone actually bought one. This is the first time.
Yeah.
That's great.
The Gravy Waltz.
I always thought God would be a woman, so you're my first guitar god that I really do worship. But how did it all begin? You know, where women weren't playing a lot of rock guitar when you began. What was the first moment that you really even wanted to pick up a guitar?
Well, you know, what was it, 1963, when the Beatles aired on Ed Sullivan, or three or four. And it was like, you know, Mom, can we have guitars? You know, so we were begging and begging and got some guitars. And then it was like the Mel Bay chord book. You know, it was like, this is an E, and this is an A. And just learned the chords, but really because I guess we had a lot of music in our family, was able to pick up stuff by ear, like Beatles songs mainly. And at that point, we had every Beatle album. And Paul Simon of Simon and Garfunkel, we learned all the Simon and Garfunkel songs in our early folk period.
Now, I learned about angst and things from Paul Simon.
Yeah.
But now, guitar players tell me that he's a serious guitar player.
Oh, yeah.
What did you learn? Did he teach you anything about, from his example, about the style of guitar?
Yeah, I learned a lot of my finger-picking style from him. There's a song on Wednesday morning,
3 a.m.
Sounds of Silence, maybe, called Angie, which is all just an instrumental. You know this one?
No, that's yours.
Oh, no, that's the one I ripped off. Yeah.
That sounded great, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, it was like, oh, yeah.
That's it. You know, so that, of course, it was capoed way up here, but you're also like, you know, 8 years old, so.
I was about 9 or 10 by the time I played Angie. Yeah. So really, he was huge, huge influence stylistically.
What would have been the first concert either one of you would have ever attended?
Oh, man. When I was 10, my big sister Lynn took me to downtown Seattle to see the Chubby Checker, Dee Dee Sharp review. A whole bunch of acts like that were on tour together.
Funky Chicken.
On the Chitlin sort of circuit bus.
The Pony, the Watusi.
It was great.
What's the first show you remember?
You know, I think it was in Seattle at the Green Lake Aqua Theater when Zeppelin was there. And they were just... with Three Dog Night, which actually made it very surreal and cool.
Something for everybody.
Yeah. But yeah, I remember Zeppelin and feeling like I was doing something wrong, you know.
Well, we left during the Lemon song, remember?
Yeah.
We went, oh, goodness. You know, we know what they're saying.
How did Led Zeppelin change your life, and how did you even first hear them?
Well, the first time I heard them was... I had a boyfriend who ran with a really slippery bunch of people, and they used to all get together and have parties and do Reds and listen to Zeppelin.
Speed, right?
No, Downers.
Downers.
And
whatever.
Which one?
Whatever.
One or the other.
Whatever it took to get you all slippery for Zeppelin. And I went to this party with him and witnessed this, and way down inside, that reached me. That reached me.
It spoke to you.
And I went, oh my God, this is scary / incredible, you know? And from then on, I just started letting them in. And
she came home and was like, oh my God. We were wrong about Led Zeppelin.
Really, the Lemon song's okay after all.
They're cool after all.
But yeah. Then when Zeppelin IV came out, it was kind of like an epiphany, a Zeppelin epiphany. You know, I mean, that was when we had Heart together, or we were forming Heart, and we were still playing clubs, and everybody wanted to hear Zeppelin, so Heart learned all the Zeppelin stuff. We did like a 25-minute long Zeppelin medley that included all these songs from every stage of Zeppelin thus far, and it brought the house down every night. And that's when I kind of changed from being the chick that sang the ballads to the only person in the band that could sing up that high and sing that way. And that kind of kicked me in the butt to sing rock more.
What's the true story of how Heart came together?
Well, I was in a band called A Boy and His Dog in Seattle, and we weren't really going much of anywhere. I think we'd reached the top limit of our potential, and so we sort of split up, and we answered an ad in the Seattle Times from the band Heart that was looking for a new lead singer and a new drummer, and it just so happened that me and the drummer from Boy and His Dog were good pals, and we stayed together, answered the ad, and they hired us. And we just started learning songs and playing in bars, and pretty soon we were the biggest group in Seattle, and then the biggest group in going out to Montana and Idaho and all these other places. And then I fell in love with the guitar player Roger Fisher's big brother, Michael, who was living in Canada to avoid the Vietnam War draft. And I was so in love with him that I was kind of blinded to everything else, and I left the band to go be with him. I went up to Canada and followed him and lived with him and was in love with him. And pretty soon, you know, we had 6 good months of romance, and then pretty soon the rest of the guys in the band came up and wrecked it all. And we put the band back together up in BC, in Vancouver. And I was saying to Nance, come join the band, but she was in college.
Yeah, I knew I had to do a little college. Being a little bit younger, you know, I wasn't old enough to play a lot of the clubs. And
But I ended up playing in little coffee houses anyway for a while, and it was good. I knew that if I kind of branched off from Anne at least one point in my life, that it was good for me as an individual, you know, to bring something back to the table. So it was cool because by the time, you know, I was ready to come and join the band, we were really dying to be together again and to write songs again. And we had a lot to talk about, you know.
And we had a record deal.
And there was a record deal.
Yeah. Then we made Dreamboat Annie, and pretty soon we got to come back to the States when that person, Nixon, gave amnesty to the draft evaders. And then we were back here again, and the rest of the story is known.
When you listen back to Dreamboat Annie, what does it mean to you? Because that's a record that, you know, it was a hell of an introduction.
Yeah. That's a cool record.
Yeah, when I listen to it, I'm really amazed that it was a hit, because it's so different than everything that was, well, there it is right there. It was so different than everything that was going on, and that probably had a lot to do with why it was a hit. But it's so, there are songs on it like, Love Me Like Music and I'll Be Your Song, you know, or The Soul of the Sea, you know, that are really long shot songs. And no one told us what to do. In those days, no one expected us to have a hit. So they said, just bring your little songs, whatever they are, and we'll just record them, and we'll see if we can get it played.
Did your family support what you were doing? Because it was incredibly unusual for women to be pursuing a rock and roll dream then.
They really are smart people, and we're a very tight-knit family. They were really like, they understood about music. They know the joy of playing music, and they knew by then we'd already been in bands in the living room and played around in local places, you know, even when we were little. So they understood that we had something and that might actually work for us. It was a long shot, though, for sure. But I think they were really supportive.
Yeah, and there was a real strong current driving Heart in those days, too. I mean, we really wanted it. Bad. We really worked hard, and I think they saw our work ethic and went, yeah, who cares what the job is, particularly this work ethic is really intact.
One of the songs that defined Heart early on for people is Magic Man. What was the spark of Magic Man, both the lyrics and the music? What got that song going? Because it sort of exploded, you know, in your career.
Over to you, Anne.
Yeah, well, you know, that was a song about my first love, you know, and like how sweet it all was and how I just was so in love. You wouldn't know me, you know, you wouldn't have known me.
Lifetimes ago.
Yeah, lifetimes ago, I was like a little hippie wifey type person. Nothing against that type of person, because I was one. Brown rice eating, washing the clothes and the sheets by hand and hanging them out to dry in the fresh Canadian air so that, you know, we would have a fresh bed at night, right? And doing all the stuff by hand and doing all the cooking and all this kind of stuff and writing songs about how much I loved it too. And one of them was Magic Man, you know?
And musically, where did it take off from? What was the starting point?
I'll play that.
We were gonna go, well, first it was gonna be like Grapevine, you know, like. And then it was going to be, you know,
but then it seemed like it was like,
hoyo,
hoyo, you know, so like, went, no.
Start raining.
So we deserted that groove. And then we came to do,
yeah, so, cold late night so long ago.
See, I can't do that song very easily anymore because it's just,
lyrically,
like I said, it's another, that the person that wrote that is just another person.
Right.
So it's very hard for me to resume that form.
So there was magic, but the magic wore off pretty quickly.
Yeah, the magic wore off.
Okay.
Yeah.
But don't forget about a lot of the younger girls out there that the magic is, you know, they relate to that, or they remember that time.
Yeah, they can.
For them.
They can always buy the CD and find it fresh and unchanged.
I guess we're not doing Magic Man this summer. We'll change the words around. Or...
Yeah, we could
oh,
do
we
the,
could do the
tribal version. Yeah, we'll do that version.
Little Queen comes out in 1977. How does that album hold up for you? It was good for me. What was it like
for you?
It
was good for me.
It was a trippier record, I guess.
Yeah.
if I could say that. It was kind of a psychedelic record, but still really emotional.
And the track Barracuda itself really sort of showed you could rock as hard as anybody. Was that a big song for the group?
Yeah. It possibly is the song that will be remembered the best.
Heart, the Ooh Barracuda Band.
We've seen
that in parentheses.
I think that song shows us at our most angry. And it was as pissed off as anything that came out of Seattle in the 90s, definitely.
That was the first Seattle sound.
It came out of Seattle in the 70s.
Well, it was the second Seattle grunge wave.
Right.
First one had, you know, Louie Louie and all that.
That worked out pretty well, too.
Yeah.
Dog and Butterfly is really a record that, even in its title, sort of defines Heart for me, you know, the sides of Heart. And I would say that Zeppelin maybe helped set up the idea that you could do both, and do both brilliantly and even mix them. Did you walk into the studio with that idea in mind?
It was a particularly bottleneck time for us as women in the rock industry, because Cream magazine was starting to write about us all the time, and we had a Rolling Stone cover or two, and there was the question of women being relevant to rock and women being credible in rock. They weren't sure about us, whether we were credible, and so that album really was the one that where we felt like we had to push, you know, we had to prove ourselves.
Now we're going to have a scary phrase for you. Welcome to the 1980s. A fitting reaction. What was going on inside Heart at the dawn of the 80s?
These strange cracks were forming in the cohesion of the band unity, you know? And strangely enough, the cracks went right down gender lines, you know? And that's how it always is in Heart. I don't know why. I don't think Nancy and I are particularly bitchy women, but it just always seems to happen that way.
We're not that hard to live with. Really, we're not.
No, really, we're not.
No,
really,
no, really, we're not.
But there formed this grand canyon between the men in the band and the women in the band.
Plus, there was jealousies because the attention was always focused on the two of us, because I guess we're just the most obvious thing to focus on.
And the love relationships were breaking up.
Yeah, so it was a triple, quadruple whammy.
Yeah.
Kind of all through the 80s there. And then that's when we sort of went back and tried to, you know, the lifespan was done for Heart, so we went back and changed the band, got the new record label and the new management company, and kind of, you know, just, wow, we plowed through those 80s, man.
They basically took us aside and said, times have changed. If you want to have big success now, this is what you got to do.
Big hair.
Big success, yeah. Big hair.
Big costumes, big hair.
Yeah. And at first it was really fun. I mean, it was a lot of fun. It was theater.
Yeah.
You know, and we got to get really super dressed up and do these videos and stuff. I think it was when it became the expectation that it got to be really a drag.
We have a picture of you guys in the 80s, and I want you not to feel at all bad, because just so you know, I had big hair in the 80s too. Look what happened to me, so count yourself blessed. When you think back on that era, when, you know, you had a, really it was the second coming of Heart, and having huge hits, what do you think about those hits? What do they conjure up for you?
One of my theories about the 80s and the music of the 80s that we all went through is that, like, the 60s and 70s were kind of defined in many ways by the shrooms and the drugs and the things, you know, the mind-expanding type of drugs that were going on at that time. And then in the 80s, it sort of shifted into more of a cocaine-type culture, where the psyche, you know, the culture was more about an ego thing, and it was like the drug was, you know. And so I think it really kind of defined the time. It was a very self-centered, ego-driven time, you know.
Definitely.
And really a lot of high highs on stage during those times, because mm-hmm. we had those huge places and there were
big hits.
Yeah, and there
Number
were moments
ones,
where
yeah.
all those big lighters were going, and you know, it was pretty cool. Never gonna come out and sound bitter about that stuff either, but it was a little hard to live behind because the image of it was so intensely unreal. You know, it was the extensions and the, you know, the my feet hurt just thinking about the 80s, you know what I mean? The corsets and the, you know, all the stuff, you know.
My nail beds have never been the same since.
Right. One song from the 80s that I just love is These Dreams. And that song was written by, it's Bernie Taupin and I believe Martin Page.
Martin Page, yeah.
Bernie Taupin from Elton John collaboration.
From Elton John fame.
Such an honor for us to get to do,
yeah,
make a hit out of some Bernie lyrics,
oh,
you know.
Yeah, like a dream to come true. That was originally written and offered up to Stevie Nicks, as a matter of fact, and she declined. And we heard that tape, you know, when we were listening, have a listening day of all these different songs that might be a hit for Hart. And our then producer, Ron Nevison, said, well, this is just a cool song, but it's no way is it right for Hart. And I heard that song and I went, oh, yes, it is. It's mine. You
that,
know, I'll take
that
it.
That was a marriage made in heaven.
Yeah.
Nancy's voice in that song was just.
So we should probably just go and sing it.
Please.
Okay. Woo-hoo.
Outside every morning. princess. Freedom is a kiss, but the prince hides his face.
Singles soundtrack, soundtrack for a film directed by Cameron Crowe, a great film. It sort of became the introduction to Seattle for a lot of people. And on that album, there was a group named the Love Mongers.
The Love Mongers, that's right.
What was freeing about that? How was that different than if you had had to put it through the heart machine?
It was like unzipping the 80s suit and stepping out. It was really going back to square one.
Yeah.
And seeing the eyes of the people that came to see you, you know, in the clubs and stuff.
Yeah.
So we just did, we were gigging around. We did go back to clubs, and we played a lot of benefits. And no managers, no record companies. We made a record on our own dime. And
two records.
A couple of records, a Christmas album and a...
Whirly gig and a Christmas album.
Yeah. And we had a blast doing it.
You also did some soundtrack work, some score work on another one of Cameron movies, A Little Picture, called Jerry Maguire.
That's right.
Can you tell us a little bit about how you approached, you know, the score for that movie and how that process works for you?
Well, I slept with the director and I got the gig.
The hell with this credibility stuff.
Yeah. Well, you know, the first thing he said was, you know, there's just this one themey thing that I have in mind that's very much like Paul Simon, that really great guitar, you know, kind of like April Comes, She Will kind of thing. And so I went, oh, I put the capo on, and I went, you mean like this, right? He went, that's it, you know? So, you know, through the process, like all musicians do, of kind of borrowing from our mentors, came the Jerry Maguire theme. You know? And then it goes on. And then I went to the studio and I put all the rest of the percussion.
So beautiful.
Yeah, I know.
that's where I always
live.
Well, that's where I get the whang, as Nancy and Cameron call it, the whang, where where you've just laughed and then you cry and then you laugh again.
Yeah,
you know,
the whang. So I felt like in doing that and also Vanilla Sky, which we just finished, I've been able to, and Almost Famous, been able to really learn a lot musically that I can bring back to the table when we fire up the heart thing again this year. So I feel really lucky to do that.
Now, all the great harmony singers in musical history, the greatest have been families, but also there doesn't tend to be a lot of harmony within those families. You know, we have the other Wilsons in California associated with the Beach Boys, the Everlys, you know, who sing like angels together,
but don't
actually talk to one another,
the Kinks,
apparently.
The Kinks were really fisticuffs, the fisticuff brothers.
How have you kept this love alive?
You know, it hasn't been exactly peaceful every single minute. We can get real frosty, but we don't fight, you know, like most people would think of fighting. But this time of Nancy going and scoring and being with her husband and her own family and having her own life has been really great, a great decompression period for us where I think now when we get back together, it's going to be fresher than fresh. Giving each other space is how we do it.
When you hit the road this summer and you play Love Alive, I don't know if it was written about what love it was written about, but does it at all about the two of you now?
Well, it didn't start out being that way, but I think that that's one of the songs whose lyrics kind of have made the test of time, passed the test of time. They're universal enough, you know? And you could use it to talk about Nancy and I, or you could use it on a global level, you know?
Can we hear a little bit of it?
Okay, let's see. It's going to start. Okay. All right, I got it now. The sky was dark this morning when I raised my head. I stood at the window, darkness was my pain. Suddenly a sunbeam arc thrilled me to my weary heart. It was the prettiest thing I'd ever seen. I knew I had to keep my love alive. Yeah, keep my love alive. Oh. And so on. So forth.
Question for each of you. What has music brought to your life? First, Anne, what do you think music has brought to yours?
Oh, well, to me it's brought a core purpose. You know, I'm a mother too, so that's right in there too. But and the love of my family is too, but a core, just central driving purpose. And it fills me. It's my brand of spiritualism, my brand of religion.
Yeah, I was gonna say that. It's religious for me because it's like music has all the gods swirling around in there.
Yeah.
It's completely magic to me too. It's, you know, like you can create music and you can hear music, but really it's just in the air, it's invisible. So, it just comes to you through the air. It's pretty hard to define, and that's what's so great about it. There's no...
And it's ever elusive.
It's elusive, yeah.
Now, don't be humble on this question. What do you think your lives have brought to music? Nancy?
I think for a lot of women, we've brought a confidence to get out there and I'm gonna go ahead and play that guitar after. You know, a lot, we've heard that so much along the way. And I think that's one of the most important things we ever could have brought to this, is a chance for women to, you know, kind of shed the shackles of expectation, not even just in music, but in the world, you know. And freedom, you know, equality, all those old chestnuts that, you know, that still apply.
We've gotten a lot of letters, lots and lots of letters from people who've said things like, you know, I was all set to off myself.
That's right.
For instance. But then I heard Love Alive, and it reached me on a level that made me change my mind. And that type of thing, I think, if you're lucky, if you're an artist and your music can help people fill their lives, be a soundtrack to people's lives in a helpful way, then I think you've really done something worthwhile.
Before we say goodnight, can we hear Crazy on You?
Oh, yeah.
Great. Thank you. Annie and Nancy. Good.
We may still have time. We might still get by. Every time I think about it, I wanna cry. With the bombs and the devil and the kids just keep coming. There's no way to breathe easy, no time, no time to be young. But I tell myself I'm doing all right. There's nothing left to do.
Protest song that was really bad.
It was don't be a,
yeah.
It was don't be a fool, go to school.
Don't be a child, don't be a fool, go to school. At school you can learn about the